As promised, 2 hours of open forum today. If you have a question about the Catholic faith, Catholic people, Christianity more generally, religion more generally, ethics, philosophy, you are welcome to call. It's an open forum. If you're Catholic, you're welcome to call. If you're not Catholic, you're welcome to call. 888-318-7884, our number. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and in studio with me, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, Jimmy Akin. Hello, Jimmy.
Howdy. How's it going, Cy?
Very, very well. Look at what I have right here.
What do you have right there?
I have a copy of Teaching with Authority, How to Cut Through Doctrinal Confusion and Understand What the Church Really Says, and it has your name on the bottom of it.
Yes, I've seen you with this book before. Have you read it?
No. Let's put it this way. I have read in it.
Okay. Well, something to look forward to. Yeah, okay. I won't give anything away.
Was that, should I have done the white lie thing there? I don't know what you're
doing. No. I did it just to put you on the spot.
Okay. All right. I think you're supposed to tell the truth, right?
But yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Mostly.
Mostly. Yeah, right. That's true. You can always there's the classic. Do you have Anne Frank hiding in your attic, or do these pants make me look fat? Those are two where you are.
Where there are alternative facts.
There are alternative. Yeah, right. Or tactful ways to avoid the question. 888-318-7884, the number, 888-318-7884. And we mean it about non-Catholics. The show is called Catholic Answers. You're probably listening on a Catholic radio station, but non-Catholics are more than welcome here. 888-318-7884. Already, this happens too when we have our apologists, Jimmy or Tim here for 2 hours. Usually we get a flood of calls. People think, now I got my chance. And already the calls are coming in. So, dial now or keep dialing. If the lines fill up, they also become available now and then. But since we're filling up already, Jimmy, shall we just go to the phone lines? All right. Let me find out who's on the phone. So I got to go to a little document here we got. And that would be Craig in Savannah, Georgia. Oh, I love Savannah, Georgia. It's one of my favorite cities. Listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Craig, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi, Jimmy. The question I have is, St. Paul tells us to admonish those who are falling short, who are living in sin, so that way they're presented perfectly before Christ. How do we go about doing that without really upsetting people?
Well, it's not always possible to admonish people who are sinning without really upsetting them. So we shouldn't have an unrealistic expectation that they're never going to get mad. We do, though, want to maximize the chance of them growing closer to God and minimize the chance of pushing them farther away. And the approach that's going to be needed is going to depend on a number of factors. It's going to have to be tailored to the individual person. When Paul talks about admonishing sinners in his letters, what he usually means is people who are within the Christian community, people who have already made a commitment to be Christian and therefore who have embraced, at least in theory, Christian moral principles, and it's a matter of exhorting them to live up to those principles that they have themselves already committed to. But if someone's not a Christian or not an active Christian, a different approach entirely can be warranted. We see this, for example, in Acts 17, when Paul speaks to a group of pagans at the Areopagus in Athens. That's a kind of discussion club that they had. And rather than just reading them the riot act, he takes a very different approach, because he's been in Athens for a while, and he's been going around the city and seen all of the idols in the city. And Luke tells us that he's personally grieved by all of the idols he's seen in Athens. But when they invite him to speak, he doesn't immediately say, "You're a bunch of idolaters and you're all going to hell." Instead, he takes a common ground approach. He says, he phrases things positively. He looks for opportunities to compliment them, and he says, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you're very religious." And he then, he says, "As I went about your city, I saw your various objects of worship, and I also found an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.'" because the Athenians recognized that they weren't worshiping all of the gods, and they were right about that. There was one they were missing. So he says, well, what you've been worshiping without knowing about, I'm now going to tell you about. I'm going to tell you about the true God who made heaven and earth. And he even quotes some lines from Greek authors who were pagans, but they expressed some truths. And he then uses those truths and builds on them and eventually gets around to saying, now, based on these truths, we should not assume that God God is like anything created. It's not going to be like an idol, for example. It's not going to be like a reptile or a bird or something like that. And so we shouldn't worship those. Instead, we should worship the invisible true God who made heaven and earth. And so you see how he's gotten around to the subject of idolatry, and we shouldn't be idolaters, but in a way where he's framed the issue positively instead of just condemning them. Now, that approach, that positive approach, is one that is especially necessary most of the time when we're dealing with anybody, if we want to get a favorable hearing, but especially if we're dealing with someone who's not even a Christian yet. You kind of need to, at least much of the time, you need to get them to the point of recognizing the truth of Christian moral values. That doesn't always mean directly evangelizing them. It may mean, for example, using the kind of common ground arguments, or a kind of common ground argument known as natural law reasoning, because human nature is built a certain way so that if we do certain things, we're naturally going to be happier than if we don't. And so even if you had somebody who, let's say they're severely abusing drugs, you know, and it's ruining their life, we don't have to necessarily get them to the point of accepting Jesus Christ before you can say, look, these are making you miserable. I want what's best for you. I want you to be happy. And I know you may think you're getting that, but the rest of your life's falling apart, and you're going to be happier if you're able to get off of these. And so you don't always have to get them to the point of being, of consciously embracing the Christian faith, but you do, in every circumstance, want to communicate that what you're telling them is because of love, and also because you want them to be happy, and this is going to result in them being happier. So I would say, in general, now, you know, there are exceptions sometimes, like if a parent is dealing with a child and the child's doing something the child really shouldn't, the parent may need to be abrupt with the child. And the same thing can happen among adults, although it's less common among adults because adults have a gift of reason that children don't have fully developed yet. But in general, we want to be accurate with what we tell people, but we also want to present it to them in the most loving way possible. St. Paul has some advice that he gives Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, where he talks about ways of admonishing people gently. And, you know, Paul's famous for having used the expression that we as Christians need to be speaking the truth in love. And that's really the key. We want to present people with moral truth, but we want to present it to them in a way that's loving and that's at the right time and that has the best chance of bringing them closer to God.
Craig, thank you very, very much for that call. Again, our number, 888-318-7884. It is open forum. I don't know if you've ever been to Savannah, Georgia, where Craig is, but they have one of
I've been to Georgia.
Savannah has one of the best collections of antebellum housing in the United States, and it's beautiful. And I mostly wanted to tell you that because I just wanted to use the word antebellum.
Okay.
I love to use fancy words when you're on.
Let me know when you find a place that has really nice antediluvian households.
That's funny. I just don't know when the Duluth
so
was,
though. If we're going to use these highfalutin words, we should explain them for people.
Yeah, antebellum means before the war, before the Civil War in that context. And antediluvian means before the flood.
Right.
Before the deluge. We better take a break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
1 John 2:27 reads, "You have no need that anyone should teach you, as his anointing, the Holy Spirit that is, teaches you about everything." Sounds pretty Protestant, doesn't it? No living teaching authority and just me and the Holy Spirit? Was John Protestant? Absolutely not. And here are some reasons why. First, John can't be rejecting a living teaching authority because in 1 John 4:6, he instructs his readers that the apostles' teaching is the criterion for discerning truth from error. So what does John mean? He's warning his readers against false teachers. In 1 John 2:19, he writes, "Some went out from us, but they were not of us." If false teachers, well then there must be true teachers. Sure, the Spirit teaches Christians the truth, but he does so through the living teaching authority, not apart from it. I'm Carlo Broussard with the Ready Reason for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
I enjoy hosting Open Line Tuesday because of the variety of questions that our listeners call in with. The show also gives me the opportunity to personally connect with Catholics and non-Catholics all over the world, telling me as host what their cares and concerns are in the areas of faith, family, and fellowship.
Open Line with Father Wade Menezes, tonight, 10 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Answers on the go, half price digital sale, not over yet. 2 days remain, 50% off all ebooks, e-magazines, downloads of MP3s, including Tim's ebook, Behold Your Mother, and he's got a bunch of MP3s on there. And I was thinking, why did they mention Tim? And I know why, Tim's stuff, but I'm not going to say. Visit shop.
He's ordinarily the one on Tuesdays.
Yeah, they thought Tim was going to be.
He's traveling today.
Yeah. Visit shop.catholic.com to take advantage of great deals on hundreds of digital products. And by great deal, we mean half off. Shop.catholic.com. Jimmy Akin is our guest. Jimmy is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. He's the podcaster behind the podcast called Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, which is growing in popularity.
Yeah,
and
it is.
Yeah, yeah. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Is that well, I don't know. I was going to ask you about how podcasts grow, but it's mostly word of mouth.
It's
right?
Word
people
of mouth,
say, hey,
basically.
I've heard this great podcast.
Yeah, people recommend it. They share it with their friends. They write reviews that tell various people to put it up in their algorithmic rankings and stuff.
Uh-huh. Any clue? You know what's on this Friday?
Yeah. This Friday is one that was requested by our patrons. It's going to be on a very mysterious object that no one knows what it is, called the Betz Sphere. It was found in 1974 in the woods. It's a metallic sphere.
Yeah.
It's just a sphere, but it displayed really weird behavior. I mean, really, really weird. Bunches of kinds of weird. And nobody has been able to figure out what it is.
This is a perfect Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World episode. All right, back to the phones. It's open forum. Mark in Boston, Massachusetts is up next. Mark's listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Thanks for downloading the app, Mark. Your question for Jimmy.
Hi. This is going to sound like a strange question, I think, but
that's okay.
I've done time in prison, and I've been really struggling with, can everyone truly be saved, even if they've done horrible things, but like regret it? Like, what does the church, like, I keep reading over and over again the part where, like, some people's hearts are turned to stone and there's just no going back. I mean,
The reason that people's hearts are turned to stone is because they turn them to stone. God is always willing to forgive anybody who turns to him. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says there's no sin, no matter how bad, that the church can't forgive if the person repents. And so everybody can have confidence that if they repent of whatever they've done, God will forgive them. God's mercy is infinite in the sense that it's capable of covering every single sin. The only time people end up not being forgiven is if they don't repent and seek forgiveness. If they're just closed off in themselves, which is another way of saying if they have closed themselves off to God's love and forgiveness, then God's going to respect their choice. But God is always willing to take people back no matter what they've done. This is the point of the parable of the prodigal son, where you have a genuine son of the father who leaves the family, goes off and leads a life of gross sin, and then comes back to the Father and is welcomed back. And God's willing to do that for all of us, no matter what we've done as long as we repent. And when you read about people's hearts being hardened, it's because they hardened them and God is simply respecting their choice to be hard.
Mark, does that help you?
Yes, it does. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Sure thing.
God bless you, Mark. Thank you very much for the call. 888-318-7884 is the number. Kathy in San Antonio, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio is next. Kathy, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I'm calling because I'm curious as to how priests verify a instance where someone is demonically possessed. Is there like certain criteria that need to be met?
Yeah, there are a number. One of them is the person needs to, it's basically a process of elimination. You look for other possible explanations, because demonic possession, at least these days, is not all that common. It does happen, but it's not as common in our age as it has been in some other ages. And so in investigating a case of reported possession, a priest will want to eliminate alternative explanations. And these include things like hoaxing. Sometimes people will be hoaxing just to get attention. Other times, people will have a mental illness. And it's really the mental illness that's resulting in manifestations which would be interpreted by the people around an individual as demonic possession, when really it might be schizophrenia or something. Or even the person himself might think that their mental illness is demonic possession, when really it has an organic cause. So those are some of the criteria. In terms of positive indicators of demonic possession, one would want to see things, and want in quotation marks, I suppose, one would need to see things that indicate, for example, the manifestation of a demonic personality, so something other than the person's own personality. That also is being openly hostile towards God or the faith. And that then is, especially if it's also backed up by manifestations that would not be producible naturally. So, you know, something is supernatural is going on here, and it's not simply a deliberate effort at a hoax or mental illness manifesting itself in some way.
Thank you very, very much for that call. Kathy, we appreciate it. I hope that that's helpful to you. As I said, there are just lots and lots of calls today, so we'll just keep moving. Zach in Hershey, Pennsylvania, watching on YouTube Live. Thanks for joining us, Zach, on YouTube. Your question for Jimmy.
Hey, gentlemen. Thank you for taking my call. So I have a long story, and I'm going to condense it down.
Thank you.
I'm a chaplain's assistant in the U.S. Army. And I'm looking at my career advancement, and there's really not a ton of advancement, but I feel a strong call to go ahead and work in the faith.
Mm-hmm.
I'm considering going to seminary with an Eastern Rite Catholic Church. Now, I was raised in the Latin Rite, but we have some Byzantine parishes nearby. Is it generally frowned upon by Eastern Rite seminaries for Latin Rite Catholics to go?
So let me make sure I understand the situation, Zach. You currently are a chaplain in the military, correct?
A chaplain's assistant.
Chaplain's assistant. Okay. And so you have not yet been ordained as a priest. Is that correct?
No. Okay. And I'm married as well. So
and
that kind of puts the kibosh on a Latin Rite.
Correct. what I can tell you is that in order to be ordained, you, and it seems like you already understand this, you would need to be an Eastern Rite priest. And the Eastern Rite married priests, I'm not sure how many are being married in this country at this time. I know when Eastern Catholics began to come to the United States, The U.S. Catholic bishops felt that it would disturb the Latin Rite faithful, which at the time certainly were the vast majority, and still are the majority in the United States, to have married Catholic priests around. And so there was a prohibition on ordaining married men in this country. I suspect that may have been modified, because even in the Latin Rite now, we have some married men who've been ordained in this country. But you would need to become an Eastern Rite Catholic, and that would involve formally changing rites. Any Catholic can just go to the Catholic Church of his choice. It could be Eastern Rite, it could be Latin Rite. You can go wherever you want to attend services, but actually formally switching requires some more effort and can't be done just willy-nilly. One of the reasons for that is to protect the different rites so that their members don't just automatically get sucked up by another rite that happens to be more common in an area. But the way the Code of Canon Law describes this, describes the process of formally switching rites, actually has a kind of a workaround that is not it's not in the books, but it's how these cases actually get handled. And what you would basically need to do is after you find an Eastern Rite parish, and after you've attended it enough to know that this really is the way you want to go and live the rest of your life as this kind of Catholic, and that's, you know, something that's very beautiful, but depending on your background and what you're used to, it may or may not be for you, and you need to carefully discern that. You would then talk to the pastor of the local parish, who would refer you to the eparchy, and your own diocese would get involved, and a transition could be made in terms of what attitudes might you receive and in an Eastern Rite seminary, and what would be the possibility of you being ordained by an Eastern eparch. That's going to entirely depend on the individual circumstances. You just have to explore the situation and see what type of reaction you get at the different stages to the process, and it might or might not happen.
Thank you, Zach. Thank you very much for the question. Again, open forum here at Catholic Answers, and we'll go to Todd in Taylor, North Dakota. Todd, your question for Jimmy.
Hello.
Hi, Todd. We're going to need you to get up close to the phone.
Yeah, I just had to switch my phone. Sorry.
No problem. Your question for Jimmy.
The question is that I understand, you know, why communion isn't offered to non-Catholics. What I'd like is clarification on why the sacrament of confession couldn't be offered to a non-Catholic. That's it, simply.
Okay. Well, in principle, confession is available to all baptized non-Catholics, provided they meet certain requirements. One of those is they have to share the faith of the Church in the sacrament. So, you know, if they just don't even believe in confession, they don't believe this is going to do anything, well, it is a sacrament, and they shouldn't be receiving it if they don't understand that God actually does work through this. Because different groups of Christians who are non-Catholic have different attitudes towards confession, that results in different criteria applying to different groups of non-Catholics. In the case of Eastern Orthodox, they share the Church's faith in the sacrament of confession, so actually it's very easy for an Eastern Orthodox Christian to receive confession. Basically, all they need to do is ask. In the case of someone coming from a Protestant background, Protestants generally do not share the Church's faith in the sacrament, and so that prevents most Protestants from being able to receive it. Also, because of other differences between the way the Protestant community has evolved in the last 500 years and the way the Catholic Church has progressed, there are a few additional requirements, like someone coming from a Protestant background not only needs to consciously, explicitly share the Church's faith in the sacrament that this God really can forgive me through this, but also there needs to be some kind of imminent need for it. Either danger of death would be one kind of grave need, or there could be other kinds of grave need, and they'd need to not be able to approach a minister of their own communion for the sacrament. And that actually is pretty easy to fulfill, since most Protestants don't practice this at all.
Yeah.
But basically, the church does want to make this sacrament available to everybody that genuinely needs it. So if there's a grave need, a Protestant can receive this sacrament. At the same time, the church wants to protect the sanctity of the sacrament by not giving it to people who don't recognize how God is working in it.
Todd, thank you very much for that question. Lines, couple lines open right now. So if you've got a question for Jimmy Akin, our senior apologist, it's open for him. 888-318-7884. 888-31-TRUTH. We'll be right back with more right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our On Fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Turns out that today, as back then, this question has a lot of different answers. So many groups want to appropriate Jesus, tweaking his identity until he looks and sounds just like one of them. But then you no longer have the Lord, says apologist Trent Horn. You have an imposter. In his new groundbreaking book, Counterfeit Christ, Trent exposes 18 phony versions of Jesus that we encounter today, helping you to recognize the fakes when you see them, explain why they're phony, and make a case for the full truth and beauty of who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Order your copy of Counterfeit Christ today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Love and beauty. As a little girl, Dawn Eden Goldstein knew that she wanted those things, that in them somehow she would find God. Over the years as a rock journalist, she moved among some of popular music's best-known artists, straining to capture that transcendent love and beauty in every note and lyric. In Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Dawn recounts her spiritual journey in beautifully wrought detail, mixing powerful accounts of trauma, healing, and epiphany with funny anecdotes from inside the music scene. It is the rare conversion story that delights as it inspires, amuses as it edifies, and ultimately lays before the reader a lived testimony to the transforming grace of Christ. Order your copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
I'm Gloria Purvis.
And I'm Deacon Harold. The Morning Glory team talks about modern-day modesty.
Tomorrow morning, 7 Eastern. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
You can hear in Gloria's voice when she teases back to us, she wants to say hi to me. You can hear that, can't you, Nick? Yeah.
You know that hearing secret messages in recordings is a symptom of schizophrenia, right?
No, it's called delusion
of reference.
Oh, all right, fine then. Let us go. Hey, we got a caller from Australia. We got to take them quick when they call from Australia. We don't want them going anywhere.
Time runs faster there.
It does it?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I was not aware of that. But everything's upside down. Victoria in Australia watching on Facebook Live. Thanks for being with us, Victoria. Your question for Jimmy.
Hey, Jimmy. Hey, Cy.
Hi, Victoria.
I was listening to the Call to Communion program, and I heard something that I just need some clarification on. So Dr. Landis spoke about a person who's been excommunicated not having access to the sacrament of reconciliation.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was a bit strange, because I would have thought the person would have access to it so that they could come back into the church. I suppose I'm trying to find out what the process is for a person who's been excommunicated, being able to come back into the church.
Okay. Well, actually, they're still in the church, even if they're under a penalty of excommunication. Excommunication is a legal penalty that's used to alert people, including the person who committed an offense, that they've done something really bad and they need to make it right. And in the case of a person who's been excommunicated, one of the ways that the church uses to help wake them up to this fact is by saying you can't participate in the sacraments. You need to get right with God first, because to be guilty of an offense that's this grave that you haven't repented of is put your soul in a position that it would actually be dangerous for you to receive the sacraments without repenting. And so the procedure in general terms is for the person to repent, and then depending on the type of excommunication they have, they might either go to a priest or their local bishop, or in some cases they might even have to go to the Vatican. Like if they physically assaulted the Pope, under ordinary circumstances, only the Vatican can release that excommunication. And so they need to go to the appropriate authority and say, I repent, I want to have the excommunication lifted, and then they can be absolved. And that might happen in the case of a sacramental confession itself. It might happen outside of the sacramental confession. Also, there are provisions, of course, in emergency circumstances for this to be dealt with on an expedited basis. If it would not be possible for them to contact the appropriate authority for an extended period, for example, then a lesser authority could lift the excommunication. Also, if they're in danger of death, they can receive the sacrament right then and there. They can repent despite the fact that they'd been under a sentence of excommunication, because the church really wants to make sure that before a person dies, he has the opportunity to repent and receive sacramental confession no matter what else has happened. That's always an option.
Okay, Victoria?
Okay, that's great. Thank you. Can I just say, I've always meant to say this to Jimmy, I find it hilarious every time you try to rush someone on when they wax lyrical and you just go, what's your question? Yeah. I just needed to say that.
I try to be nice about it, you know.
I'm glad. Are you saying, Victoria, that not everyone can succinctly state a question?
Oh, no. Everyone can succinctly not say their
does.
Question. Not everyone chooses to.
Victoria, are you anywhere near Perth?
I'm in Darwin, in the topmost end of Australia, the pointy end.
Okay. Oh, okay, because
just this weekend I was doing a dance called South Australia.
Oh, and what form of dance is that?
Oh, it was a Morris dance.
A Morris dance called South Australia. Well, Victoria.
And we sing about South Australia in it.
I don't know if you have like planes and trains and stuff there, but if you do, we're going to be October 17th through 19th down in Perth at Corpus Christi College for the YB Catholic Conference. They've invited a bunch of Catholic Answers folks to be there. And it would be wonderful to meet you and maybe get another question from you stated succinctly and plainly.
Absolutely. Thanks, guys. You guys are wonderful.
Thank you, Victoria. 888-318-7884 is the number. I forgot the last number there for a second. Did you see that? I forgot the last digit.
Sudden onset acute enumeracy.
I was like 88 something. I don't know. Okay, we'll just go to Steven. Steven knew the number. He dialed it. He's in Texas listening on the EWTN app. Steven, your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy. First, I'll say I love your podcast. Look forward to it every week.
Oh, thank you.
So here's my question. Previously, you answered a question I had about the infallibility of canonization, and I kind of have an expansion upon that.
Okay.
Let's say, hypothetical situation, a canonized saint, we learn canonized saint from a long time ago, we learn someday that there was something like not morally right with his life, or something he did, who knows, but like, would that affect the validity of his canonization and whether or not he's a saint?
Well, again, it's going to depend on the way he was canonized, and it's going to depend on whether saint canonizations are infallible. If he was canonized by popular acclaim rather than by a pope or hypothetically an ecumenical council, then you would not have a presumption of infallibility. He would still be on the books if we discovered, oh, he committed some horrible thing that he never repented of. I mean, saints have committed horrible things and then repented of them, Saint Peter being a good example of that. So as long as they repented before the end of their life, then it's not going to affect things. But if we found really good evidence that someone had had done something horrible and not repented of it before they died, then they'd still be on the books as a saint, even if it was by popular acclaim. The church in that situation might choose, though, to say, okay, given our new knowledge about what this person did, they're no longer suitable to hold forth to the faithful as an example to be followed. And so so the church might then suppress the veneration of that saint. And that's happened a few times. It's happened in church history that a saint has had their veneration suppressed. It's called suppression of cult.
Oh.
But it hasn't happened, so far as I know, because we discovered they'd done something bad. It happened for other reasons. Like there's too many saints on the calendar and this one is really minor and they're not venerated all over the world. And in this case, maybe we're not even sure they existed. It's just a popular acclaim thing.
Yeah.
In terms of after papal canonization began, well, if saint canonizations are infallible, then it would mean this person is in heaven, which means even if we found evidence that they had done something really horrible and we didn't have evidence that they had repented of it in this life, we would be able to infer from the fact that they're really in heaven because this is infallible, we'd be able to infer, well, then they must have repented. It was just in a way we didn't observe. Because, you know, people can repent of things even in their last moments of life when they're not able to speak anymore, for example. So we would need to infer that something like that had happened. On the other hand, if saint canonizations, papal saint canonizations, are not infallible, then that would it wouldn't tell us what the fate of the person was, but it would be some negative evidence towards the idea this person is in heaven. But again, the person would still be on the books as a saint, regardless of whether the person is in heaven. If we discovered they'd done something really horrible and had not repented of it, and we could prove it, you know, not just some people said this, but we really could show this actually happened, then the church, whether the person's in heaven or not, might say, you know, this situation is too problematic to continue to hold this person out as an example to the faithful. And so even if they're in heaven, the church might say, you know, we're going to suppress their veneration so that the faithful do not receive a confusing signal about morality.
Thank you very much, Stephen, for that question. I hope that that was helpful to you. We got to go to a quick break, but before we go to the break, I want to remind you that our Catholic Answers Conference is now a mere 2 months away, right? Yeah, two months away. And we've got room for you. As a matter of fact, Erica, who runs events here, has made extra room, or she's negotiated extra room. The original room block sold out, but she secured 15 additional rooms, and you'll still be getting a great deal on these additional rooms. So you can go over to CatholicAnswersConference.com to find out all about it, to make your reservations. We're going to do two tapings of, I don't know why she said tapings. No, we're going to do two live shows, 4 hours of radio live there. We got tremendous speakers, Monsignor Eugene Morris, Father David McConey, Rod Bennett, Bishop Frank Caggiano, Father Paul Check, along with all of our wonderful speakers here, Carlo, Trent, Tim, and our own.
Somebody else, I think. I'm not
somebody
sure.
Somebody else called Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. No, that's not
a person.
Oh, okay. There's somebody else called Jimmy Akin. Oh,
okay.
It's going to be there talking about
stuff.
And in addition to talking about stuff, which now I really don't want to miss that. I mean, I know you're going to be talking about stuff. He'll also be calling a square dance,
yeah,
which was a highlight last year. And there's also a free cookie for everyone who registers.
Whose image is on the cookie?
It is not Caesar. I can tell you that.
Good. Well, wait a second. His name starts with a C.
Yeah, it's me, Cy Kellett.
Yeah.
But wait, so render unto Cy that which is Cy's then. Everyone could give me their cookie.
Oh, they could, but I think the idea is for them to have the cookie.
All right, that's fine. Go to CatholicAnswersConference.com. We want you to come. Hey, if you're local and you're not going to stay at the hotel, that's fine too. There's a conference ticket that for everybody. Everybody, there's one for everybody. Go to CatholicAnswersConference.com.
This is Harry Connick Jr., and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
You remember the time I said on the air, go to confession, and when you're done, go out and have a big ice cream soda. Celebrate. And a man wrote to me, he says, you know, I hadn't gone to confession in 30 years. Do you mind if I went and had a pizza? I said, oh, have 20 pizzas.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
You know, I often hear that Harry Connick Jr. saying, well, you're listening to Catholic Answers Live, but what do we ever do for Harry Connick Jr.? He did that for us. What do we ever do for him?
He gets to listen to our show for free.
Yeah, but I just wanted to, he's on Broadway right now. So I thought I'll give him a little plug for his Broadway show.
Okay.
It's called True Love, a celebration of Cole Porter, Harry Connick Jr.
Uh-oh.
You can catch him on Broadway. If you have like $1 million, I don't know what Broadway tickets go for.
I don't think they're that much.
No, you don't think you could get them for less than $1 million?
I think so.
But Harry Connick Jr. is worth it. Okay, it's open forum. Rod in Brighton, Michigan.
Ron.
Listening. Excuse me, Ron. I apologize. Ron in Brighton, Michigan, listening on Ave Maria Radio is next. Ron, your question for Jimmy.
Hi. Yeah, I heard recently that the Attorney General of the United States recently reinstated the death penalty for federal cases, and I understand he's a Catholic. And I'm wondering if that's as egregious as Catholic politicians that are pro-abortion.
I would say no on two grounds. The first one is that even though there are alternatives to the use of the death penalty is not intrinsically wrong the way abortion is intrinsically wrong. Abortion is the deliberate killing of an innocent human being. And that's always wrong. Deliberate killing of an aggressor, however, is not intrinsically wrong. And so it is something that historically there have been many situations where it was justifiable. And today, in the judgment of many churchmen, you know, we have better alternatives, but it's not intrinsically wrong. And so that is something, at least that's my understanding of the situation. And so that's one reason why a person who supported capital punishment and was even involved in it, like, you know, reinstating it on the federal level for certain crimes, would not be as guilty as someone promoting abortion. The second reason is vastly more people are killed by abortion than the death penalty. The number of people who are killed by the death penalty is minuscule compared to the millions that have been killed by abortion over even just the last few years. And so the problem of abortion vastly outmasses the number of deaths that are the result of the death penalty. And so that would be a second ground why someone supporting the evil of abortion in America would be in a far worse position defending themselves before God than someone who supported the death penalty.
Does that satisfy you?
Yeah. I was worried because the bishops are all upset about this, and I didn't know if that was, how as a Catholic I could think about it.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, Ron. I appreciate it. I didn't know the Attorney General was a Catholic, but I also hadn't thought about that. Just the sheer number of deaths involved. Mm-hmm. That's something worth considering there.
Mm-hmm.
Ron, thanks very much for the call. Let us go now to Wes in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, listening to EWTN online. Wes, your question, please, for Jimmy Akin.
Thanks for taking my call, guys. My question comes from
one of my high schoolers in my youth group, and I'm hoping to maybe be able to give him a better answer.
Okay.
But he's wondering if God knows everything, then he ultimately knows if a person will decide to reject him, and as a consequence of that, go to hell. And so they're wondering, well, how can we say that God is so loving if he would create a person who would ultimately end up in hell? And so they have a hard time understanding why hell would even be an option if God is so loving.
Yeah. This question comes up periodically, and I think there are two approaches to it that are promising. One thing I want to point out is notice that there's a presupposition built into the question. It's not just that God knows what a person will do before he does it. God is outside of time, remember? And so he sees all of history all at once. So nothing is future from God's perspective. God sees the past and the present and the future all at once from the eternal now. And so if he creates somebody, then he sees all of that person's history. Now, in order for him to avoid creating the person that will choose not to go to heaven, he would need to know what that person's free will choices would be, even if he didn't create them. Okay? So let's suppose he does know that. That kind of knowledge is one that theologians have proposed. It's called middle knowledge, for reasons we won't go into, but it's called middle knowledge. And it's the idea that God knows what the free will choices of people would be, even if he never makes them. And in that situation, God could refrain from creating the person on the grounds that that person will choose to reject him. So how might we be able to understand from that perspective why God would go ahead and create them anyway? Well, it's not unjust for him to create them because he's being fair with them. He's given them a choice, and if they chose otherwise freely, he would have brought them to heaven. Another fact that would shed light on that situation is, well, let's think about hell. How bad is it really? Now, obviously, it's bad. It's not a desired outcome. But you could argue that still, even people who go to hell come out on the plus side. They still get to exist. They still have certain, they still have the benefits of existence. Even if they have frustrated themselves by cutting themselves off from the source of all goodness, and so they do have some frustration, they might still end up on the plus side, in which case God is still being loving to them. I mean, he brought them into existence. He's letting them have all the benefits of existence. Yeah, they're frustrating themselves some, but they still are coming out on the plus side. So it seems to me that those would be two factors that would be relevant to how would this work if God has middle knowledge. Number one, justice is still happening, and he really did make them this offer, and they choose to reject it. And then B, they're still coming out on the plus side anyway, even though they're not in a great condition. But does God have middle knowledge? This is a proposal from theologians. It is not the teaching of the church. And so there historically have been theologians who've said, no, God doesn't have knowledge of free will choices that have never been made. The idea of knowing the outcome of a free choice that never gets made, that sounds like a logical contradiction, like a four-sided square or a married bachelor. If it's a free will choice, there is no outcome until it gets made. And so to say that God would know free will choices that never get made would be as nonsensical as saying God knows the perimeter of a four-sided triangle. You know, that's just gobbledygook. It doesn't actually mean anything. And so if God doesn't have middle knowledge, then he doesn't have the option of not creating someone on the ground that he knows what that person's free will choices will be. He has the option of creating them, and he has the option of not creating them, but he doesn't know the outcome of free will choices the person doesn't make if he doesn't create them. And in that case, if he goes ahead and creates the person, well, it's at that point that he sees, okay, here are all of the person's choices. And so he couldn't refrain from creating them on the grounds that he knew what choices they would make if he created them, because that's like a four-sided triangle. The outcome of a free will choice that's never made is undefined.
Wes, we will leave it there. Thank you very, very much for that question. As I have said a couple times, it is busy here. The phones are busy today. There's a line open now. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. It's open forum, so whatever you got a question on is welcome. Let's go to David in Grover Beach, California, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. David, to get a full answer, you are going to have to be kind of quick with your question. What's your question for Jimmy Akin?
Real quick, I read two Bibles. One Bible is from 1975 that I got when I was baptized, the Golden Rule edition of the New Catholic Bible, and I'm also reading the Revised Standard Version, the Second Catholic edition. Now, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, on the Lord's Prayer, one of them says, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors," and the other ones, "Forget our trespasses as we forgive our trespasses."
Mm-hmm.
So what's the two difference and why was it changed?
In this case, well, it's not that one was changed. These translations both presumably said what they do from when they were first published. The one that's the more literal translation is what you're reading in the Revised Standard Version. It's the one that says debts and debtors. That's a literal translation of what the Greek says here. But because in English, we don't tend to think of sins as debts, when the Lord's Prayer was originally translated in English, or at least somewhere along its history in English, it became common in Catholic circles to say, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us," because it was easier for English speakers at the time to understand trespasses as sins as opposed to debts as sins. And so the older Catholic version is reflecting the traditional English translation of the Lord's Prayer, whereas the Revised Standard Version Catholic edition is more literally translating the Greek. I might point out this is actually something that was an issue back in the first century, because in Greek culture, debts was not used as a metaphor for sin. And so it was confusing for Greek speakers too. And that's why if you look at Luke's version of the Lord's Prayer, he translates debt in the first instance as sins.
Yeah.
Just forgive us our sins as we forgive those who are indebted to us. And so this has been an issue even since the first century. In Hebrew culture, they did have debt as a metaphor for sin, but when you try to bring that across into other cultures, whether it's first century Greek culture or medieval and modern English-speaking culture, it can get confusing. And so alternate translations have been used.
Okay, David?
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. Does the question ever come up to you in those kind of situations where there's any kind of ambiguity in Scripture? Yesterday we talked about the word porneia in mm-hmm. one part of the Scripture.
Yep.
Do you ever get the question, well, why would God allow it to be unclear like that?
He wants us to wrestle with it is one reason.
Yeah,
he doesn't want to just give us the answers. That's why Jesus talked in parables, so we'd have to think about it and thus internalize it more deeply.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons prophecy is written in symbolism, so we have to think about it, and so we internalize the message. Also, language is a rich phenomenon, and there are multiple meanings frequently that are simultaneously being conveyed by a text, and if God reduced it to being flat
scientific
literal,
language or
then
something,
it would lose those additional meanings, or it would have to multiply in length and become mind-numbingly technical.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. So you have thought about this before.
I have thought about many things before.
Jimmy Akin's our guest. Guess what? He's our guest next hour as well. We're going to continue with this open forum with Jimmy. 888-318-7884, the number. I see two lines open right now. If you're on the line, please stay on the line. We're going to do our very best to continue to move through the questions and give you the very best answer we can. If you haven't called yet, as I said, two lines open. Can I just say this one more time? You don't have to be Catholic to call. Anybody's welcome to call. Is that correct, Nick? That is correct. We'll see you on the other side of this break for more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live. We'll be right back.
Hang on, we'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
Atheists have a new tactic when it comes to talking about the existence of God. Your arguments in favor of God don't even deserve a reply, they say. Because not only does God not exist, he doesn't even matter. In his new DVD, Why God Still Matters, apologist Carlo Broussard doesn't let them off so easy. He takes apart the premises of those who say God's irrelevant and teaches you what you need to demonstrate why God is just as important. In fact, in today's world, more important than ever. Don't let atheists shut down the argument before it begins. Get your copy of Why God Still Matters by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is apologist Trent Horn, and I'm here to tell you about a truly unique resource that's just come out from Catholic Answers Press. In Scripture, Jesus answered his critics again and again by using their own words against them, showing how even the enemies of the faith admitted crucial facts that undermine their own position. And it's been that way through the ages. It's proved impossible for those out to destroy the faith to mount their attacks without tripping themselves up and inadvertently testifying to the truth of what they're trying to destroy. In his new book, Hostile Witnesses, How the Historic Enemies of the Church Prove Christianity, best-selling author Gary Machuda looks at dozens of Christianity's most notorious foes, from biblical times through the 20th century, and draws from their antagonistic words and deeds surprising testimony to gospel truths. From the Pharisees to the Nazis, from the Crusades to the Reformation, he presents a parade of skeptics, heretics, pagan powers, and rival sects, each taking a turn in the witness's chair and giving an unexpected but compelling account in favor of Christ. If you love apologetics, you need to order your copy of Hostile Witnesses today by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or by asking for it at a Catholic bookstore near you.
Robert Hugh Benson's masterpiece, Lord of the World, is in a word, prophetic. Originally published in 1907, it depicts a world where religious doctrine is not tolerated, euthanasia is practiced widely, and the leader of the world is a benign-looking politician intent on the destruction of religion in the name of truth. Author Dale Alquist said it best. Whether or not Monsignor Benson's picture of our future is accurate, the fact is his picture of our present is chillingly accurate. Recommended by Pope Benedict XVI and Pope Francis, Lord of the World is a must-read. Order your copy of Lord of the World now by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
The Christian faith is under constant attack today in numerous ways, but the attack that does the most damage is the one that asks a deceptively simple question. What if Jesus never existed? This is exactly the tack taken by some skeptics today, and make no mistake, the freewheeling and often fact-free nature of many internet sites has allowed this way of thinking called mythicism to spread far and wide. The skeptics come with arguments to cast doubt in numerous ways, attacking the dating and accuracy of the canonical gospels, and arguing the church left out other gospels that would have told a different story. The good news is that there are answers to each and every one of these charges. Good, solid answers. That's why Catholic Answer Studios has just released Jimmy Akin's new DVD, Why You Can Trust the Gospels. It's a powerful presentation in which Jimmy takes on the skeptics and refutes them point by point, revealing how evidence from non-Catholic sources and even tiny details in the Gospels that you've never noticed before show how the Gospels are a true and accurate record of what our Savior said and did. Order your copy of Why You Can Trust the Gospels today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or by visiting the shop at Catholic.com or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
like these things when we get the apologists to come for 2 hours. I love this when this happens. Tim's been doing it lately. I really enjoy it. I'll have to tell Darren. This is my new favorite thing. 888-3187-884 is the number. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin has remained as our guest. We're having a great summer afternoon here. Hope you are as well. You are welcome to call with your question about Catholic faith, Christian faith in general, religious faith and practice. And if you want to talk about Egyptian history, I know Jimmy loves to talk about that.
Sure.
A little philosophy, little ethics. It's all welcome.
A lot of the Bible.
A lot of the Bible, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Please call with your questions about the Bible. 888-318-7884. Again, these lines just will not loosen up, Jimmy, so we'll just keep plowing along. Todd in Wisconsin, you are up next. Your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi.
Hi, Todd.
First, thank you for taking my call. Thanks for taking my call. My question is a follow-up on an earlier question about Protestants being able to receive confession.
Mm-hmm.
I have a real-life story where I have a friend that was diagnosed with ALS and he's going to die in 3 months.
Wow. Sorry
and we
that.
Were having a discussion. We're having a discussion about the afterlife, and I asked what he believed, and he told me he believes that his sins follow him to heaven. And I said, well, you know, Scripture says nothing unclean gets into heaven, so I'm not sure how that works.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked me what we believed. And I explained to him how we have the sacrament of confession. And I actually happened at the time we were on our way to a healing mass. I had a examination of conscience. I gave it to him. I let him read it. And he looked at me and he asked, can I go to confession?
Uh-huh.
And I'm Wonderful. Like, well, we could ask a priest. And I asked the priest, and the priest said, no. He said, he cannot. He's not Catholic.
Okay.
And I didn't tell my friend that the priest had told me that. I told him I got to check into a couple more things, and I subsequently asked two other priests that told me the same thing.
Hmm.
And, you know, I'm right now it's causing me to wrestle with my faith in that here is a priest who is supposed to be the persona of Christ,
mm-hmm.
and somebody's coming to him asking
yeah.
for absolution or forgiveness of sins.
Let me clarify a couple things. Your friend is baptized, correct? He's
yeah.
a Christian. Okay. And did you explain that he's in danger of death from ALS imminently?
Yes.
Okay. I'm very surprised that you got this reaction from three priests, because I would think at least one of them should be educated enough in the church's pastoral law to know that that's not what he told you is not accurate. I'm going to read to you from the Code of Canon Law, and I would suggest that you write down the number of the canon that I'm about to read to you. If you don't have something to write with right now, then just, you know, go to Catholic.com and listen to this part of the show again. The relevant canon is 844, Section 4. It is the part of the Code of Canon Law that deals with the ability of non-Catholic Christians who are in the Protestant community to receive the sacraments. And it builds on something that is in the previous section of the canon. In Section 3, it addresses the situation of Eastern non-Catholic Christians. So like, you know, people who are Copts or Eastern Orthodox or Assyrian Church of the East, but they're not Protestants. They do have all seven sacraments, and they have the church's basic understanding of those sacraments, so they can receive them in more circumstances. And the Canon 844, Section 3 says that Catholic ministers can give them three sacraments, penance, so that's confession, the Eucharist, and the anointing of the sick, pretty freely. But then the next section of the canon, Canon 844, Section 4, deals with the situation of people from the Protestant community. And here's what it says. This is the church's official law. If the danger of death is present, so that's your friend who's in danger of dying in 3 months from ALS, if the danger of death is present, or if in the judgment of the diocesan bishop or the conference of bishops, some other grave necessity urges it, Catholic ministers administer these same sacraments, that's penance or confession, the Eucharist, and the anointing of the sick, licitly, that means lawfully, also to other Christians not having full communion with the Catholic Church, that's Protestants, who cannot approach a minister of their own community and who seek such of their own accord, provided they manifest Catholic faith in respect to these sacraments and are properly disposed. So your friend clearly asked on his own accord. Now, it is okay to suggest to people, would you consider this? But what the church doesn't want us doing is like forcing them.
Okay.
But that's not what happened here. Your friend asked on his own accord. A priest would naturally want to say, now, you believe God can help you through this? And he says, yeah. And the examination of conscience he's made are going to make him properly disposed. And he can receive the sacrament of confession. He could also receive the anointing of the sick if he accepts that God could help him through that. And even if he accepts the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, he could receive the Eucharist. Because the danger of death applies here, and so he could potentially receive all three of these sacraments. And I would suggest talking to a priest and saying, let's go through Canon 844, Section 4, and talk about how that relates to the situation of my friend. And if you continue to have difficulty with a priest, talk to your bishop. Because your bishop is going to have all the canon lawyers he needs to help make sure this guy gets the pastoral care he's asking for. And frankly, I'm really surprised that you would find one priest, much less three, who would take this attitude, because if someone is dying and asking to receive grace from the church wants to make that happen.
Todd, what do you think?
Yeah, got something to go on. I appreciate it.
Okay,
I get it done.
You got those references to canon law?
844, yep.
844, Section 4. Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Todd. Really glad you called. Appreciate it. It's not a question that I have heard asked here before, and it sounds like it's a very important one. Maybe that will be of great use to other people.
I've had it in my own family.
Have you really?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And were you able to resolve it?
Yes, I was.
Okay. Well, sounds like you had to open a can.
I had to use a can opener, let's put it that way.
Okay. Let's go to Mike in Madison, Wisconsin. You are up next. Mike, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Yes, I will try and be succinct, as
Thank
I
you.
Have heard you request that before.
Awesome. All right, Mike.
I have an ex-wife. We were married 24 years. She asked for divorce 10 years. Into our marriage, I had a near-fatal accident causing a brain injury, and 14 years after that, she asked for a divorce out of the blue because she was tired of being my caregiver. Mm. And I learned through the process of divorce, everything comes out in that, that she had been suffering from depression since high school.
Mm-hmm.
So she had been hiding that from me all through divorce, or all through our marriage. And when I asked for an annulment, it was denied by my archdiocese, and I had to go all the way up to Italy, mm-hmm. and it was denied there as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I was a medic in my fire department, and somebody at my fire department put me on Match.com. I met a woman, and we dated for a little over a year, and we were engaged for 16 months, and we're now married not in the Catholic Church, but married legally.
Mm-hmm.
I'm concerned what that does for myself and for her.
Okay, Mike, that's a tough one.
Okay, it is a difficult situation. The church understands that marriage, the legal phrase is marriage enjoys the favor of the law, which means the church assumes that any marriage that people attempt to celebrate is going to be valid unless the contrary is clear. And this is a principle that Jesus seems to have endorsed. He assumed if two people got married that they were really married and really bound to each other for life. Consequently, the burden of proof is on whoever would want to say a marriage is not valid. in a particular case. In the case of your situation, the church, you know, looked at the evidence that was presented at the time, both on the archdiocesan level and then also, I assume, you appealed to the Roman Rota, and the church said, we can't, at this point, find evidence that would show this marriage was not valid from the beginning. It may have acknowledged that your wife was suffering from depression early on, but that may not have been enough to deprive her of the ability to genuinely consent to marry you. And so the church feels bound then to honor Christ's teaching on the indissolubility of marriage and assumes that you're still married to her. And that's one of the factors that is present in this situation. In terms of what to do practically, well, if it's true that you're still married to your first wife in God's eyes, that does put you in some jeopardy, given what you're doing right now. And if you're leading a normal marital life with a woman that you're actually not married to, you would be in the situation that Jesus talks about, where he says, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. That would be your situation. In terms of how to remedy it, there are a number of options. One option would be to reinvestigate the annulment process if you're able to produce new evidence that wasn't able to be produced at the time. Maybe there are some additional witnesses that could bring forth facts that would have a bearing on the case. I would suggest potentially consulting the St. Joseph Foundation for that's based down in San Antonio, Texas. They're a group that is meant to help the laity pursue their rights, and they would be able to help you explore what might need to happen in order to get a new investigation of nullity going, if that's possible. It may or may not be possible. If you're not able to obtain an annulment, if you are able to obtain an annulment, then the thing you need to do is convalidate your current marriage. If you're not able to obtain an annulment, then you have a couple of options if you want to protect your soul. One of them is one of them would be to live as brother and sister. So, you know, continue to live in the same household, but chastely. Another would be to separate if it's too difficult to live in the same household chastely. Another option is if there were evidence that that really is conclusive that your first marriage was null. And this is not something that you should be self-diagnosing, because it's too easy to rationalize your own situation. But if you've exhausted all legal recourse and you're convinced that the first marriage really was null, even though you can't prove it in court, then you could be subjectively justified in acting in accord with that. This is what's sometimes called an internal forum solution, because the relevant issue can't be proven externally in court. That's the external forum. But this is like a last resort thing. The church recognizes the internal forum as a possible way of resolving difficult pastoral situations, but it is not to be it is not to just be used to excuse things, which it sometimes has. But that's kind of an outline of your basic options. One thing you might bear in mind is the law concerning annulments. I gather that based on what you've said, that the attempt to get the annulment occurred some time ago, and the law regarding annulments has been substantially revised in the last few years. And so that may create new opportunities for you to pursue an investigation. And you could either approach your diocese directly, but if it were me, I'd kind of first get an opinion from the St. Joseph Foundation about what's the best way for me to approach my diocese. And they may be able to help you out in that regard.
Mike, thank you for the call. I hope that was helpful. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Jimmy Akin Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN, helping people grow in their love and understanding of God.
I just want to share that 5 years ago, my lovely warrior princess and saint of a wife and I decided to adopt a little girl through foster care. She is the perfect roundout of our family of three boys and her. Yes, there are challenges. Very grateful today for all the blessings that he has shown our family.
EWTN, live truth, live Catholic.
Got a free ebook for you, The Early Church Fathers. You just go over to shop.catholic.com, click on the Early Church Fathers banner, and download your free copy of Getting Started with the Early Church Fathers today. There's only two more days left on this one as well, so to get all that free stuff and the discounts and all that that are up for July, you only got a short time to do it. Head over to shop.catholic.com, click on the Church Fathers banner, and get your free copy of the ebook, Getting Started with the Early Church Fathers. Open forum, Jimmy Aiken, lots of calls. Let's go to Mike in Michigan, watching on YouTube Live. Mike, your question for Jimmy.
Yeah, hi, Jimmy.
Hi, Mike.
Yeah, so my question is, I'm Catholic, but I do speak to a friend of mine who's not. Mm-hmm. He did ask me a question that was really hard to answer. The question is, if we didn't ask to exist, yet our souls are eternal, mm-hmm. and by not choosing God would result in eternal hell, how is it just, or how is it right?
Okay. So there are a couple things to bear in mind here. One of them is if a person is not aware of God through no fault of his own, God's not going to punish him for that fact. God only holds people accountable for what they know. And so if someone innocently is unaware of God's existence or what God wants from them, then God's not going to punish that person on that account. And it will be possible for him to be saved as long as he otherwise does live up to the knowledge he does have of, you know, what's right in the world, and if he knows about God, being open to God, and so forth. So, and we really can't judge one way or another, but basically an individual person's case, because we can't see their heart. But it's not like if someone doesn't have a conscious acceptance of God, they automatically go to hell. That's not the way it works. So, if someone comes into the world. Now, it's obviously impossible to ask someone if they want to exist before they come into the world, so they kind of have to do that or they don't exist at all. But then, if they exist and they choose to live up to the light that they do have, whether it includes a conscious knowledge of God or not, then they're going to get to go to heaven and be with God forever. And that is to the plus. So there's no ground for charging God with being unfair if they get infinite happiness. On the other hand, if they say, you know, I don't want to be with God, and they reject God, whether it's consciously or not, they don't live up to the life to the light that they have, then they are God's going to respect their decision. But at that point, he's respecting their decision. He's not being unfair to them either. They have chosen to live without him, and he'll let them. So either way you go, God's being fair with these people. He's given them existence. He's given them a choice. And if they choose to live up to the light they have, then they'll get infinite happiness. If they choose not to, then God will respect their choice in that situation as well. And as we discussed in a previous call this hour, even if they're not in heaven, they may still end up being on the plus side of the equation. They may experience more benefits just from existing than the frustrations they encounter by cutting themselves off from God.
Mike, thank you very, very much for that call. I've always found I enjoyed existing.
Mm-hmm, me too. Most people do.
Yeah, it's one of the better things about being human, existing. Mm-hmm. Adriana in Virginia, you are up next. Adriana's listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Your question for Jimmy.
Hi. So I'm going to college soon, but the college I'm going to is a large Protestant university.
Mm-hmm.
It's mostly evangelicals that are attending there. And the problem is that because I'm Catholic and not many Catholics go there, they don't really have like a Catholic church on campus. And then recently I have been trying to look, see if there's one near campus, but it's more like into the city kind of. It's more like about 8 or 7 miles out there. However, they don't provide the buses or the service to go out that far.
Oh.
And my mom was—I was just talking about it with my mom. And she said she doesn't feel comfortable with me like going out that far away from the campus. So she said I could watch the Mass online. However, I wouldn't really get like the Eucharist and all that. Mm-hmm. And I was just wondering, if I wouldn't be able to, make it to Mass on like a Holy Day of Obligation per se. How would I handle with that?
Okay, Adriana.
Well, if you're genuinely not able to get to Mass in a reasonable way, then you don't have a Sunday or Holy Day of Obligation. The Church recommends that in those cases, you do something to be closer to God, and watching Mass on TV would be one of the things you could do. You could always watch a replay of the Mass on the Internet. If one's not being broadcast that day, there's, easy to find video footage of Mass. Also, just spending time praying or reading the Bible is also something you could do as part of the recommended alternative if you're genuinely not able to get to church. It sounds like the distance is not that huge. And, obviously, if you're in college, you may not have a lot of money. You might not be able to Uber it. St. Alphonsus Liguori would not say you need to walk 7 or 8 miles. That would excuse you if you wouldn't need to walk that distance. It sounds like you've checked with the parish and said, do you have a bus or pickup service that you send around to the college? And they've said no. What I would be inclined to do at that point is look for a fellow Catholic on campus, or who lives just outside of campus. It may be an adult, maybe not a student, maybe a Catholic family. Say, hey, could I get a lift with y'all?
Mm-hmm.
And I would pursue those options, because I'm guessing there's probably some way you can make this work reasonably. But if on a given day, whether it's a Sunday or a Holy Day of Obligation, if you genuinely can't get to Mass in a reasonable way, then the Church understands that. But it is a recommended, though not required, thing to do, that you do some kind of alternative spiritual exercise.
Does that resolve the issue for you, Adriana?
It shouldn't be, because I do know someone who could take me to Mass. However, she's very Protestant, and mm-hmm. she says I can just go to her church, but I told her, it's not the exact same.
Right.
Because, there are some, differences between the evangelical and the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
However, she says, you'll still be getting God, but it's not, the exact same.
Right. And it sounds like you have a good approach there. I would just, you will, going into this environment, you will need to take steps to protect your Catholic faith, and there may be people who will try to pull you away from the Church. If that happens, be sure and contact us here at Catholic Answers, because we've got lots of resources to help you out in those situations. So you do need to preserve your Catholic faith, and to the extent you can, you need to preserve your Catholic practice. If you've got someone who's willing to take you, I would say take them up on it. Now, you might find somebody else, too, with some time, who maybe you won't have to have that kind of discussion with. But in talking to your evangelical friend, if she's saying you're still going to get God, you can say, I recognize that and I appreciate that, but I'm a Catholic, and I need to do things the Catholic way. And so if you can take me to Mass, that's awesome. You're even willing to attend with me, because after all, you're going to be getting God there too. So it might even turn into an instance where you can evangelize her. But just be firm on the fact I'm a Catholic, so I need to do things the Catholic way, and I really appreciate all your help and support.
I hope that that was helpful to you, Adriana. Appreciated the opportunity to address your question. It is open forum here, and we got still a bunch of people on the line, but there is one line open if you'd like to call with your question. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. I mentioned a little earlier that we're going to be traveling to Perth, Australia in October. And then in November, a whole bunch of the Catholic Answers crew is heading up to join Spirit Catholic Radio at their conference. Tim's going to go. Trent's going to go. I'll be there. Our president will be there. And then our friends Matt Fradd and Ray Guarendi will be there. Find out all about that at spiritcatholicradio.com. That's in Omaha.
Catholic Answers Live.
In his new audio presentation, The Very First Fathers, apologist Jimmy Akin takes you on a tour of the earliest Christian writings outside the New Testament, from the most famous figures and most notable works to those lesser known but no less important. This pivotal time in the development of the early church is revealed in fascinating detail. Jimmy shows how, even in the first century after the resurrection, it was necessary to defend and explain truths that are still under attack today, such as the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and the perpetual virginity of Mary. The Very First Fathers is a compelling look at the dawn of the Christian age and edifying listening for anyone who wants to understand and defend the full truth of Catholicism. Order your copy of The Very First Fathers today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. It's free, and you'll have instant access to our daily broadcast, the schedule of upcoming shows, and you'll even be able to search the archive and listen to thousands of past shows. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Have you subscribed to the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter? This is Catholic Answers Live host Cy Kellett, and I want to tell you about our new weekly newsletter full of behind-the-scenes information and facts you need to know about the show. It's easy to sign up. Just visit CatholicAnswersLive.com and look for the newsletter sign-up box on the front of the page. It's a great way to keep up to date with what's happening with the show and see what's coming in the days ahead, delivered weekly into your inbox. Sign up today for the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter and see what you've been missing. Go to CatholicAnswersLive.com.
I'm Gloria Purvis.
And I'm Deacon Harold. The Morning Glory team talks about modern-day modesty.
Tomorrow morning, 7 Eastern. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Open forum. We are just plowing through the questions today. A lot of questions. A lot of people. It's funny how a couple people have teased you about keeping their questions short. Uh-huh. But people really have done it today. Like, this
That's
has
awesome.
Been an extraordinary
yeah.
day. It
makes for better radio.
When you call in with a question to a call-in question show and have a question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And don't lather it up with a bunch of unnecessary stuff.
Lather it up is exactly right. Up next is Patrick. Are you there with us, Patrick?
Yeah.
And how old are you, Patrick?
6.
And do you live in Missouri, Patrick?
Mm-hmm.
And is it hot in Missouri, Patrick?
Mm-hmm.
And do you have a question for Jimmy Akin?
Uh-huh.
All right, what's your question?
Why did Jesus die on the cross for us?
So that we could be saved from our sins and get to go to God and be with Him forever in heaven. That's the basic answer. Is that enough for you, or would you like some more?
That's enough.
That's enough. Okay. Thank
All right.
you.
All right. Well, enjoy your evening in Missouri, okay, Patrick?
Okay.
All right. Yeah. Thank you for calling us. That was very nice.
Always want to try to give the customer what the customer is looking for. You know, there have been loads of books written on this subject, but and I could give a book-length discourse, but didn't know how much he was after. So
it is
glad that
the,
helped.
It's one of the things that we adults do is over-answer questions sometimes.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, let's go
so
to...
So why is the sky blue?
The sky is blue because it I can't even say refracts today. I don't know. What's wrong with me, Don?
I thought you were about to say reflect the ocean, but that's not the right answer.
No, I was, you know, I think that might have been my brain was trying to say reflect, but my mouth was trying to say refract or the other way. Anyway, scratch that, reverse it. Don in Raleigh, North Carolina, listening on Divine Mercy Radio. You are next, Don. Your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi, thank you for taking my call, and I really enjoy your show. I wanted to follow up on the gentleman who was concerned about hardening the heart.
Yeah.
And there is, unfortunately, one very, very disturbing passage in the Bible, and I believe it's Exodus. It's before Moses is sent back to Egypt to free his people. Mm-hmm. And God clearly indicates that he is going to harden Pharaoh's heart so that he won't let his people go.
Yeah.
And it's disturbing on multi levels. Number one is, you know, just the fact that he's hardening the heart. But the really more damaging one is, do we really have free will?
Okay.
He can't do that if we don't have free will. If he's really hardening Pharaoh's heart, then we don't really have free will.
All right, Jimmy.
We really do have free will. And that's something that is presupposed all over the place in Scripture. Like in the Pentateuch, you know, the same set of books that contains this passage, you know, it has other passages like, I've set before you today life and death, therefore choose life.
That would suggest free will if you're going to make a choice. Yeah,
if God's telling you to make a choice. Now, we have to be careful here in a number of respects. The first one is we have to be sensitive to the mode of language that it is used in the Bible, especially early on in the Bible. God began with Israel at a very primitive stage of religious development and then gradually trained them over the course of time till they were more able to receive the fullness of his will. This is why, for example, Jesus says, well, Moses let you divorce your wives, but that's really not God's will.
Mm-hmm.
And we see similar things happening throughout the progress of the Old Testament period. If you look at the very beginning of Genesis, you have a talking snake, and you have God walking in a garden that's a literal physical garden, and he's got like a body and stuff like that. And he's also made the day and the night even before the sun and the moon exist. And so all of this is a literary way of bringing across certain truths about God, but they're put in a way that appeals to the mindset of not to put too fine a point on it, of frankly primitive people.
Mm-hmm.
It's his way of communicating with them, given the language and the thought forms that were in use at the time. And one of the things you find, another one of these thought forms, is especially early on, the biblical authors tend to portray everything as if God is directly responsible for it, when really he just allowed it. A classic example of this is when David takes a census. You look in some of the historical books, it says God made David take the census. You look in other historical books, it says the devil made David take the census. What's the answer there? Well, God allowed the devil to tempt David to take the census. That's the true story. But given the ancient habit of just saying God did this whenever anything happens, some of the historical books use that mode of speech, but really all we can infer from it is God allowed this to happen. So when we then look back at the Exodus period, and we have a passage saying God's going to harden Pharaoh's heart, well, some people have noted that actually Pharaoh hardens his own heart first, and then after that it says God hardens his heart. So it's like Pharaoh's already closed himself off, and God has just said, okay, I'm going to let you do that.
Mm-hmm.
That's one way of looking at the text. Another way of looking at the text is, like with David's census, where it actively attributes something to the divine action. It may only mean that that God allowed it. But because the biblical authors want to portray God as a mighty king,
right,
everything has to be directly attributed to God, even though it's not literally the case. You see similar things in the earthly court, where in order to show proper respect for the earthly king, you don't ever imply the king doesn't know something. Like, for example, when David is on the run from Saul, at one point some people come to Saul and they don't say, guess what? David is hiding in our territory.
Right.
Which would imply he didn't know that.
Yeah.
They come and they say, is not David hiding in our territory? Implying that the king already knows this, when in fact they're using a polite way of, a polite non-literal way of telling him where David is.
Yeah.
And in the same way, you never would say a king can't do something. And so since God is being portrayed as a mighty king in heaven, you always make everything sound like God did it, even if that's not literally true and God just allowed it. And so there are a variety of reasons to see the Pharaoh narrative as not involving God just took away Pharaoh's free will. We have this known mode of speech in the Old Testament that's not literal, and Pharaoh first hardens his own heart, and we have other passages implying free will. So between all of that and the teaching of the church that we do have free will, we have ample reason for believing in free will, not to mention the fact we all have an innate experience of it all the time.
Well, I choose to believe that. Okay. Don, thanks very much for the call. I hope it was helpful. Catherine in Tulsa, Oklahoma, you are up next. Your question for Jimmy.
Hello. I wanted to ask a question about confession. I had a friend a number of years ago that had gone away from the church, and she was in the ER one evening. She was actively dying, and there was not a priest around to help her, and she asked me if I would receive her confession, and I didn't know what to do. It scared me. You know, what is the teaching on that?
Okay. Well, lay people are not able to receive confession, so we don't have the holy orders needed to absolve someone. If I was in that situation, I would be inclined to say, I'm sorry, I'm not able to personally, I mean, obviously I try to find a priest for the person, see if we can get one there. But assuming that I can't, I would say, you know, I'm not able to absolve you. But what you want to do is repent of your sins, which it sounds like you are, and you want to, you want to make what's called an act of perfect contrition, which is, and you want to just tell God, God, I recognize you're the greatest good. I'm so sorry that I've sinned against you. I wish I hadn't, and please forgive me. I want to be with you in heaven. And if she says that and means it, then that will result in her being forgiven, even though she's not able to receive the sacrament at this time. Also, I would say, you know, even though I can't absolve you, and here's what you need to do to make this act of perfect contrition, I would say, I'll be happy to pray with you. And then I'd pray with the person, and, you know, I'd pray expressly that God will give his graces to this person and he'll forgive her and that he'll help her come to be with him in the afterlife. And then if the person still says, I really have something I want to get off my chest before I die, I would say, okay, I'll be happy to listen to whatever you want to tell me. Whatever will help give you peace, I will listen. I can't absolve you, but I'll listen and I'll pray and I'll keep praying for you after you're gone. And I will also keep it secret, just as if I were a priest. Mm-hmm. I won't tell anybody else because I want you to be fully comfortable.
Catherine, so it sounds like you did nothing wrong. Does that comfort you?
Yeah, I just needed to know. I just didn't know what to do.
Yeah, and that's understandable. The laity are not often put in that kind of situation, and God knows that you did the best you could in the situation, and he loves you for trying to do the best you could, whatever the details may have been.
Catherine, thank you very, very much for the call. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
The Church has 2,000 years of wisdom to share on what it takes to live life gracefully.
We're so overwhelmed by how much our faith has transformed our marriage and family especially. We want everyone to experience the incredible gift that the Catholic vision of life and love really is.
More to Life with Dr. Greg and Lisa Popchak. Tomorrow morning, 10 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Open Forum, Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and Blaise in Colorado is next. Blaise, are you there with us?
Hi.
Hi, Blaise. How old are you?
I'm 9.
Well, we are delighted to have your call, Blaise. What's your question for Mr. Akin?
Where did God come from?
God didn't come from anywhere. God has always existed and always will exist. God does not have any beginning. In fact, God doesn't even, properly speaking, he's not inside time. So for God, there is no past and there is no future. He sees all of the past and the future all at once from what smart people call the eternal now. And so he sees all of history all at once, but because he's outside of time, he didn't have a beginning, because only things that are inside time have beginnings. And, you know, if you look at something as it begins, you see a time before it begins, and then it begins, and then it may keep existing after that, but only things in time have a beginning. And since God's not in time, God has no beginning, and thus he didn't come from anywhere. He just is.
How's that, Blaise?
It's good. Thank you.
Sure thing.
You're very welcome. You ever seen a mountain, Blaise?
Yeah.
Yeah. I kind of figured, because you're from Colorado. I wasn't sure, but I kind of figured.
Yeah.
Thanks for that call. We appreciate it. And now we have lots of other callers, so I got to keep moving. Let me go to Jeff in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio, where we're going to be in November. Delighted to have you. Jeff, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
So we're a Catholic family, and we go to Mass every Sunday. In fact, I go more than that myself. I try to. But my wife has recently told me that she doesn't really get anything out of Mass, mm-hmm. and sometimes she feels like she's just going for the family,
mm-hmm.
that she really doesn't want to be there. And you guys are married. I've got the answers, but she doesn't want to hear it from me. So
okay.
If there's something you guys can help me with sharing that with her, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, actually, Cy is married. I'm not married. I'm a widower. I would say it's understandable that she may experience times of spiritual dryness, including at Mass. That's not at all uncommon. One thing that helps me is to realize I'm not at Mass for me. I'm at Mass for God, and if I have a family, if I had a family that I was bringing to Mass, I'm also there for them. So her perspective that she's there for the family is part of the truth. She's also there for God, and she will benefit in the long run, even if she doesn't, you know, have rosy feelings at the moment. And that's all okay. Sometimes we have things to do in life that we need to do for others or for God, even though they're not, you know, are the funnest thing right at the moment. And that's okay. It's just an hour a week, a little more if you're getting the family ready and driving over. But still, it's not that big. It's not that big a deal. It's not a huge amount. And it's certainly worth saying, you know, You know, we want to raise our kids to know God, and that means we need to set a good example for them, even on the days we don't feel like it, because they're going to not feel like it sometimes too. But we all need to be sincere followers of God, even when it's not convenient. Having said all that, there are things that can help her get more out of Mass. I have a little booklet called Mass Appeal, the ABCs of Worship, that I wrote to help people get more out of Mass. Also, Thomas Howard has a book called If Your Mind Wanders at Mass that's also designed to help people get more out of Mass. So I would suggest getting something like that. And there are other books as well. There are devotional books that you could take to Mass. And you know, if you're not getting something out of what's happening at the moment at Mass, you can do some spiritual reading or praying or something to help you get more out of the experience. That's a very traditional thing to do. People have brought spiritual reading or rosaries with them to Mass throughout history. It's not the preferred thing. You know, if you can be engaged by what's going on around you at Mass, that's great. But if it's not so engaging at the moment, you can do other things to try to say, God, I'm here in your presence, and I want to be close to you, and this would help me do that.
Okay, Jeff?
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Jeff. God bless you. 888. I'm not going to give out the number. We got so many people here ready to ask questions. Let's go to Ralph in Iowa, listening on 105.3 FM. Ralph, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Yeah, Jimmy.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to different non-Catholic friends, and someone really bring up the point of the King James Bible.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And, you know, I sort of wanted, but I never have asked him, you know, why do you think the King James Bible is the one, you know? And, I mean, they got their own reasons, but I was wondering if there's a way of finding out a little bit about its history,
mm-hmm.
You know, and why it maybe isn't such an elite Bible.
So the reason that it's an influential Bible is because it was supported in England by the crown. That's why you'll hear it sometimes called the authorized version, and that's because the British monarch authorized it for use in the Church of England.
Mm-hmm.
And since England is where they speak English, you know, it's where the language came from, and after the Reformation, when the British monarchy was enforcing Protestantism in England, with very few people being able to evade having it forced upon them. And they said, this is the Bible you're going to use in church. Well, that's the Bible people used in church.
Yeah.
And then people got used to it in the Protestant community, and it stuck. And it became the standard Protestant version of the Bible in English for about 400 years, a little less than that, more like 300. And so that's why it became influential. It was published in the year 1611 by a group of scholars who were commissioned to translate it on behalf of the crown. It was not the first Bible in English. It also was not the Catholic Bible of the time. In fact, the Catholic Church had just published a Bible in English known as the Douay Rheims. So there was actually already a recently published Catholic translation when the King James came out. If you'd like to learn more about the King James, there are books that are just about the history of the King James. But also, coming up in September, in just a few weeks, just about 6 weeks from now, I have a book coming out called The Bible is a Catholic Book. And in that, I do talk about the King James and its history and how it fits into the overall picture of Bible translations. So I'd suggest getting a copy of The Bible as a Catholic Book when it comes out.
Thanks, Ralph. We've got to keep moving. David, also in Colorado, listening on 1060 AM there. David, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Yes, my question was, can a Catholic marry a Muslim?
In principle, yes. I would discourage this. And in fact, the church requires that in this kind of situation, for the marriage to be valid, the Catholic needs to get a dispensation from their bishop. The specific type of dispensation that they need is known as a disparity of cult dispensation. The reason is because Catholics and Muslims have fundamentally different styles of worship, or fundamentally different kinds of cult. And so a cult is just an ancient word that means the worship of God. And so if a Catholic is going to marry a Muslim, if it's going to be valid, they need to get a disparity of cult dispensation, and they're going to need the appropriate background, including how to protect their Catholic faith and so forth. But interreligious marriages have a high failure rate and a high annulment rate because people from other religions have a different understanding of marriage and what it's all about, and it can bring a lot of tears into a person's life unless neither of them really cares about their religion. If one or both cares about their religion, then the fact that they're divided religiously is going to be a source of pain to them.
And even if you don't care today, 10 years tomorrow. From now, you might.
Yeah.
Right. David, I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to try to get to as many as I can before we have to go. Thank you for the call. Arthur in Lubbock, Texas, you are up next. Your question, Arthur.
Jimmy was just talking to Catherine about the lady that had a deathbed desire for confession. My question is, could she have granted that through a telephone call to a priest?
The common opinion these days among theologians, moral pastoral theologians, is that you need to be present personally in order to be able to absolve someone, and therefore it couldn't be done over a telephone. However, that's a theological opinion. That's not the teaching of the church. There are and have been theologians since the invention of the telephone who have entertained the idea that it would be possible to absolve someone over the telephone. An example of such a theologian is the Jesuit author Henry Davis, who wrote a four-volume moral and pastoral theology back in the 1930s. He thought it was possible to absolve someone over the telephone. It is not something, however, that would be done except under emergency circumstances, like someone is about to die. And even then, a priest might, in that circumstance, might very well say, I would suggest do two things. The first one is say, don't actually tell me your sins. God knows them,
mm-hmm.
because we don't want the NSA or other people listening to them over the phone system. It is not secure.
No.
And secondly, so I would say that would excuse the person from needing to make a materially integral confession of their sins. The second thing is, since it's not settled that this would be valid, I would say the priest should administer the formula conditionally.
Mm-hmm.
If you can be absolved right now, I absolve you.
Mm-hmm.
And thirdly, I'd say tell the person to make an act of perfect contrition just to be certain. And all of that's speculative, and other people will have other opinions. I'm only addressing it as a hypothetical emergency and what might be done there. I'm not saying that that's what should be done.
Arthur, thanks. I'm going to keep moving. Garth in Wichita, Kansas, watching on YouTube Live. You got to be really quick, Garth. Can you do that?
Yep, I can do it. My question is, if there's a teaching of the Catholic Church that I just cannot accept for some reason, is there any point in me still trying to be Catholic, or should I just go ahead and pack myself and leave?
You should continue to be Catholic. Now, because we're going to run out of time, I'm going to recommend a book to you for follow-up on this. It's a book called Teaching with Authority. I wrote it. It deals with how to evaluate church teachings and what to do if you have problems like this. I've got a big section on how to deal with issues like this. Fundamentally, if something has been infallibly taught by the church, and there are not that many things that have, but if something has, there are a number, but it's not what a lot of people think it is, then you really need to accept those, because the Holy Spirit protects the church from error when it teaches infallibly, and you need to trust the Holy Spirit in those circumstances. If it's not an infallible teaching, the church understands that there can be situations where a person may find himself unable to accept a non-infallible teaching. And you can still remain a Catholic in good conscience in those circumstances. You need to do your best to work through the situation, to, you know, study the issue with an open mind towards what the church teaches. But if it's a non-infallible teaching and you just can't accept it, the church understands that there are going to be situations like that that a Catholic can encounter in good conscience.
Garth, I hope that was helpful to you. Thank you very, very much. Jimmy Akin, thank you very much for taking 2 hours with us today.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And this week on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World,
Sphere, mysterious object. Bent
Sphere.
No one knows what it is, but it is really weird.
All right, this is perfect. This is a perfect Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Well, that's it for us. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.